Good morning. And welcome to our worship service, the last Sunday of 2023. Okay, there's one. Is there any more? There's two in the back. Any more? There's a prize. There's a prize if you raise your hand and say you're glad. There we go. Well, we've had a good year, and we've had some had a trying year, some had a so-so year, but we made it, and thanks be to God. So I'd like to welcome our learned visitors, any visitors among us, wave your hand. Got some over there on my left side. Well, welcome to our worship service. Glad that you can... You had many choices where you could have went this morning. So we thank and praise God for you being here with us. And if you're ever in town, I don't know what's your connection, but whenever you are in the Ferguson, North County area, please stop by. We're here at 9:30 every Sunday, aren't we? Amen. So welcome again. So you have your bulletin, and of course we have announcements. So there's just a few. BCE will have their first meeting this year, on January the 2nd at 6 p.m. Mark that time at 6 p.m. It used to be 7, so it'll be 6 for this particular meeting. And then Immanuel Fellowship will meet on Thursday at 11. And we will undecorate the church next Sunday. So after worship, be prepared to transform the sanctuary again into our space of worship. And then mark your calendars, ushers. I want to let you know this early in advance that we will have an usher meeting on the 21st after worship service to go over our safety and security plan and all of that that entails evacuation and emergency situations so that we can be prepared for whatever happens. Can I have my mother-in-law, Mary Conley, come forward, please? You can just come right here, Mom. It's warm in here, or is it just me? It's the heat is on, I think. That's a song, The Heat Is On. You remember that song? No? So my mother-in-law came to me and said, you can stay right there, that she wants to join Immanuel United Church of Christ. So we'd like to take this opportunity to welcome you. You've been visiting with us now for the last year and a half, long-time visitor. But you've decided to join us, and I thank you for that. God thanks you. The church thanks you. So your ministry, your gifts allow you to work in the space because the Bible says your gift will make room for you. And I know what your gifts are, so I know it's not going to take long for you to jump right in and start operating in your gifts. So God bless you. So when you came in, our superstar was here this morning. So you probably want to get his autograph because his picture's on our bulletin. So he graced us with his presence today, Mr. Roland Hemingway. Give Roland a hand clap. So this photograph was inspired by his brother, Damien, who saw his brother praying. And he thought that was important to capture that moment. So I wanted to share that with you all this morning. Amen? So lastly, our prayer list. We have experienced a lot of loss in our church family. So we want to continue to pray for Richard Graham, the Graham family, the Kohler family, and the Westcott family. The information is slightly printed, but then also send out a constant contact with all the details if you would like to attend those services. And then our sick list, let us pray for those that are on our sick list. Gracious God, we thank and praise you this day. God, we lift up these sick and shut in and homebound before you. God, you know all their concerns, you know their needs. So God, we stand right now in the gap on their behalf to be their voice of prayer to the throne of grace. Because God, we know that there's healing and restoration in the hem of your garment. So we stand in their place to seek and ask for healing, restoration, and also, God, whatever other situation they may have, that those be addressed also, because your word said that you will perfect those things that concern us. So we thank you, God, for the opportunity to be the voice, to be the representative of those who are in need. We thank you, and we love you, and we give you praise for all things. In Jesus' name, let the church say amen. Let us begin our worship.
Let us join together for the call to worship. Praise God in the heavens. Praise God among us. Praise the Holy One.
Praise God who vindicates us. Praise God who sustains us.
Praise God from the depths. Praise God in all circumstances.
Praise God who made us. Praise God who shapes us.
Let all praise the name of the Holy One.
The glory of God reigns in heaven.
Praise the Holy One.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the journey you have taken us on. You have been with us in the valleys and on the stormy seas, as well as on the mountaintops of life. We gather before you, surrounded by your presence. All who enter this space come out of different circumstances, but with a common desire to be in your presence. We ask that you guide our hearts and minds as we turn our attention to you. Open our hearts to the power of your grace and the transforming love of your Spirit, that we may become living vessels of your love. Help us to embrace the righteousness that you offer through faith. We exalt and praise your name for all that you have done and all that you will do. As our redeeming God, renew us hope and love, that in the world holiness may flourish. Through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
Reading of Psalm 148, verses 1 through 14. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his host. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, you highest heavens and you waters above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for he commanded and they were created. He established them forever and ever. He fixed their bounds, which cannot be passed. Praise the Lord from the earth, you sea monsters and all deeps, fire and hail, snow and frost, stormy wind fulfilling his command, mountains and all hills, fruit trees and all cedars, wild animals and all cattle, creeping things and flying birds, king of the earth and all peoples, princes and all rulers of the earth, young men and women alike, old and young together, let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is exalted. His glory is above earth and heaven. He has raised up a horn for his people, praise for all his faithful, for the people of Israel who are close to him. Praise the Lord.
The second reading is from Galatians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent his son, born of a woman under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as children. And because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father, so you are no longer a slave, but a child. And if a child, then also an heir through God.
Pray with me now the prayer for transformation and new life. Sovereign God, you have been our help from age to age. Remind us to turn to you when confronted with difficult choices. Remind us that you strengthen us on the journey. Remind us that our actions and attitudes impact our neighbors and ourselves. Renew our minds and spirits as we strive to follow you. Peace in the world. Amen. Beloved, you are loved with an everlasting love by the Most High God. Know that each day is a new opportunity for faithful and flourishing life in the name and path of Jesus. Redemption is available, and God's grace is sufficient for transformation and new life. Amen. So just a quick thank you to the young people here at our church. To Luke, Allison, and Kayla for doing the liturgy for us, and then for Claire, Madison, and Mackenzie, and Mom for rendering the music for us, and Roland and Damien being our greeters at the door. So thank you all. I just appreciate you all. I really do. So thank you. So this morning, for those who received the bulletin via email or constant contact, you probably saw the marquee that says the sermon title. You're probably scratching your head like, okay, where is this one going? What did you get for Christmas? Interesting title, isn't it? No? But before we get there, I'm going to set things up for you. So Galatians chapter 4 is where we're going to focus on. But I'm going to read this passage from the Message Bible. But when the time arrived that was set by God the Father, God sent his Son, born among us of a woman, born under the conditions of the law, so that he might redeem those of us who have been kidnapped by the law. Thus, we have been set free to experience our rightful heritage. You can tell for sure that you are now fully adopted as his own children because God sent the Spirit of his Son into our lives, crying, Papa, Father. Does not that privilege of intimate conversation with God make it plain that you are not a slave but a child? And if you are a child, you are also an heir with complete access to the inheritance. So let these riches of those verses soak into your hearts today, right now, as you ponder it, so that you can realize that only that you are redeemed from the curse of the law and sin and death, with that glorious enough in itself, because we have been redeemed, but not only that, you are redeemed, but you are also adopted. You have received an adoption as sons and daughters before God. Let us pray. God, we thank you for this preaching moment. God, I ask that you calm the rivers of my heart. Allow me to speak clearly with conviction, God. Speak not just to those who are gathered here, but speak to myself. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, you are our strength and our Redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So let me kind of relax the room a little bit. So you got to pay attention. This is a good joke. So during Sunday school, the younger children were drawing a picture illustrating biblical stories, you know, biblical stories throughout Scripture. So the teacher walked by and noticed one little boy was drawing an airplane. Oh, what Bible story are you drawing? She asked. The little boy answered, this is a flight to Egypt. See, here's Mary, he was pointing at the picture, and Joseph, and the baby Jesus. And then he pointed to the front of the airplane, and this is Pontius, he's the pilot. Pontius was the pilot. So we all celebrated Christmas this past Monday with family and friends, and you may have seen people that you have not seen in a while, and maybe since last Christmas was the last time you saw them. Well, you probably exchanged gifts. You may have eaten more food than you should have. You probably still feel it. No, but let's pause and ponder some questions. I want you to ponder these questions. What effects did Christmas have on you? Were you stressed? Are you relieved that it's over? What did Christmas really mean to you? What did it really mean? Was it about the gifts? Was it about the food and the time spent with family? Think about that. Because I think if we're honest, we would say that Christmas is really about some of all of those things, right? As much as we try to say that Jesus is the reason for the season, the real reason most people celebrate Christmas is to exchange gifts and spend time with family. Those things are good to do. But what is the real gift of Christmas? What should Christmas really be about? Well, let's consider some things. Christmas is a special time of the year that captivates the whole world. Christmas is a time Christians remember and celebrate God's gift to humanity. God gave the most wonderful gift to the world that could not be purchased in any mall, any department stores, or not even on Amazon. And yes, he might have gone to Jared, but he didn't get that from Jared either. Y'all didn't get that. I'm working here. Christmas is a celebration of events that set the heavenly host to declare glory to God in the highest and on her earth peace, goodwill towards all persons. Christmas reminds us that at a specific time, at a specific place, a specific Christmas gift, the gift of all gifts, was given for a special and a specific reason. The gift was our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So I just answered the question, what did you get for Christmas? That's the answer. So my friends, what does Christmas gifts really mean for us? What does it mean for us as the Savior being our gift? What does it mean for God to have sent his only begotten Son to this world? So the passage today reveals several things about God's greatest gift to us, his Son, Jesus Christ. So the gift of Christmas, one, is redemption. Say redemption. Redemption is the act of saving or being saved from sin or evil. The action of regaining or gaining possession of something in exchange for payment or clearing a debt. One of the lessons that the scripture teaches us is that we are in debt. How many would like to be in debt to someone else? Most of you, I don't think anyone would raise their hand. Debt binds the borrower to the lender. Debt puts the person in restraints to the one that they owe. We are spiritually indebted, yoked by sin, and unable to purchase our freedom. We are like the unforgiven servant in Matthew chapter 18 who owed his master 10,000 talents, which is about $1 billion today, with no possible way to pay it back. He was in debt. He was to be in prison with no hope of release, but only by the mercy of his master was he forgiven his debt. Likewise, none of us is capable of perfectly following God's law, which is why God sent his son, Jesus Christ, to free us from our debt to sin. So if you look at verse 4 and 5, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons and daughters of God. That's the gift. Another way to say this is that God sent his only son to buy our freedom because we were slaves in sins to the law. More than that, we did not have the means to purchase our own freedom. We couldn't do enough good works. We couldn't do anything at all to buy our freedom back. We couldn't even obey God's law enough to earn our spiritual freedom. None of us goes to heaven based on our own merit. No one. We have a debt we cannot repay, so at the right time, and as I mentioned in my Christmas Eve sermon, at the perfect time, God sent his only son, Jesus, to set us free, to give you your gift that Christmas. My friends, this is what I claim as my Christmas gift, the gift of Jesus Christ. Do you declare today that that is your gift? Out of all the things that you receive, out of all the things that was under the tree that might have been in the garage with the red bow on it, all the things that was deposited. Did I hear the red bow in the garage? All the things that was deposited into your account, the gift cards that you might have stacked up, all of those could not compare to the gift of our Savior. Because that gift, my friend, transcends all time. Amen? So second, the gift of Christmas is an inheritance. Now, I love inheritance. Those are great. But because of Christmas and by God's grace, we have been delivered unto sonship out of sin and the powers of darkness and into the glorious liberty that belongs to the children of God, that belongs to us. Through the blood of Christ, we receive special privileges for being in God's family. What am I talking about, special privilege? Well, if you look at verse 6 and 7, and because you are sons and daughters, I'm talking to you, God has sent the Spirit. Look at that gift. God keeps giving Spirit into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer slaves, but a daughter and a son. And if a son or daughter, then an heir through God. Isn't that wonderful? Just to know that you're not just in relationship. Not even friendship, but relationship. But you are an heir to all that God has. A cattle on a thousand hills belongs to who? God. The scripture says, the Lord is my shepherd, your gift that you shall not want. The scripture tells you the benefits of your gift. And because we are children of God, we are in the position to receive God's inheritance, beginning with the promise of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is a sign and privilege of our adoption. God dwells within us through the person of the Holy Spirit. Sometimes we might say, well, the little birdie told me, or my conscience told me to make this decision, or I had this thought in my head. No, that was the Holy Spirit giving you direction. We can talk ourselves into a whole lot of things in life. We can justify the actions that we do just so it can make sense, so when we do it, we don't feel bad about it until it goes wrong. However, if you pause and allow the Holy Spirit to be that compass, to give you that direction, and then you move forward, you don't have to worry about the outcome because the outcome is already etched and it's already happened. You just have to have faith and believe that it will come to pass. So God dwells within us through the Holy Spirit. And by the Spirit's presence in our lives, we are truly convinced that God is for us and not against us. As parents, sometimes we have problems trying to give guidance to our children, and they don't understand sometimes that we love them and we're trying to help them, that we're not the enemy, we are not against them. We're just trying to give them the best that we can, and we get the resistance, right? But you continue to give. You continue to guide. Don't let their reaction stop you from giving because they don't realize what they need. Because the road that they're traveling, you and I have already traveled. We know the bumps. We know the turns. We know the detours. Not all of them, but what we're doing is we're preparing them so that when they get to those points in life, they can move forward. Because that's what we as adults do. We are challenged at times. So the scripture tells us we can go to the Holy Spirit. We can go and say, Abba, Father, help me. Help me in my situation. See, that's that connection. We should sense this connection every time we pray the Lord's Prayer, which begins with the most wonderful words, Our Father who art in heaven. We say this every Sunday. You might say it Monday through Saturday in your prayer time. Our Father, you're acknowledging God as your Father. So the Spirit confirms this connection. So what did you receive for Christmas? Was it a new toy or some kind of computer or gadget? Was it clothing or new tools or something to work with? Was it neatly wrapped in a bow? What was it? Or was it someone who could not be wrapped except for some old swaddling clothes and was not laying under the tree, but laying in the manger? Did you receive the Savior who was sent at just the right time to save you from the most desperate situation or circumstance? Did you receive the gift of redemption, of salvation? Or did you escape the eternal punishment that could have earned or brought us death? Did you receive the gift of family? Not the family we accustomed to spending time with every Christmas, but the spiritual family of God that endures for all eternity. Did you receive the divine inheritance, not of money or property, but of the Holy Spirit of God's presence? These are the true gifts of Christmas, not the things we purchase from the store, wrapped in paper or exchanged with each other every Christmas day. If we have never received the gift of Christ, today, my friends, receive Jesus Christ as your gift. Receive God in your heart. And for those who have already received the gift, how should you live as a result of that gift? I'm going to tell you, because I asked you the question. So I'm going to help you. So I'm going to give you four reasons or four things that I suggest. So be patient. That's number one. Remember that God's timing is not the same as ours. When the time is right, God will do what God plans to do. We just need to be ready and obedient. Number two, be thankful. Are you thankful for God redeeming you, for purchasing your life at the expense of his son's life? Think of the situation you were in prior to Christ coming into your life. Cultivate an attitude of gratitude for the freedom you have at the result of God gift of his son. And number three, remember who you are. God sent Jesus in order to adopt you into his family. Maybe your earthly family is not that good, or maybe you don't really have a family, but through Jesus Christ, we are all brothers and sisters in a great family, in God's family. So celebrate your adoption. And lastly, live like a free child of a king. Live like a kingdom kid. If God has adopted you into his family, live like a kingdom kid. Trust Christ completely for your salvation. Do not straddle the fence. Make your decision. What side are you going to be on? Because I can recommend being on God's side, because that's the best side. God did not free you so that you will remain in sin. But the good news is that this is the greatest gift that you have and you will ever receive. And I say this as I'm talking to myself, that the gift of Jesus Christ is the greatest gift. And I say to you, Merry Christmas and thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for the gift of Jesus Christ, our greatest Christmas gift. We are humble and overwhelmed to consider that you would send your only son to save us. We honor you as the perfect, all-powerful, and loving God who has no bounds. We exalt you and give you all the glory for sending Jesus, the embodiment of love and grace, to die for us and make a way for us to be right in right standing with you. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you have done to pay the cost of our sin and reclaim us as your own children, restoring a relationship with the Father that was once broken. We turn to you and begin each day thanking you that you are the source of eternal salvation. Through you, we are invited into a relationship of fellowship with you and restored. We know that you are the solid rock and our foundation, and that even in the toughest times, we can rely on your unfailing love. We bless you and worship you, Jesus, for being the greatest Christmas gift. We ask these and other things in the name of the one who taught us how to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Let us rejoice in the God of our salvation through giving. May we embody the generosity modeled by Jesus Christ, who came to serve, heal, and restore. Let us receive our offering. Thank you. Let us pray. Generous God, we thank you for every good and perfect gift you have given to us and through us. Use our offering this day for the benefit of creation, the redemption of humanity, and your glory. Amen. Our closing hymn 537, My Hope is Built. I heard some baritone and bass out in there. That sound good. That sound real good. Maybe I'll sing that song again. Do you like that, John? That sound good. Well, just going to take in this moment. Because we won't see each other again until next year. I'm serious, right? So I got to take in this moment. Look at your smiling faces. Thank you again. You guys did awesome. Thank you. Thank you. We have some talent here that's just unbelievable. So we will continue to use the talents and the gifts and all the resources that we have in this house. Okay, so all right. You want the benediction? Okay. I just wanted to stand here for a moment. So the benediction, may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine up with you and give you peace. May your homes be blessed. May every situation that you encounter this coming year, 2024, will not intimidate you, will not scare you, but will have you standing with confidence because you know that you came into that year with the best gift ever. The gift of Jesus Christ. And with that, my friends, with that gift, you have the power to move mountains. You have the power to push things out of your way. You have the power to hold on. So hold on. Don't let go. And God will see you through. Amen. Go in peace.